You know who you are?
Steven is my name.
Even Steven.
Will you say something, Steven?
Steven or else media.
You're listening to the Superman Super Show, episode number 18, Superman on the High Seas. Hello and welcome to an all-new episode of the Superman Super Show. I'm a host. My name is Steven, and 1,000 miles over there to my right is another host, Mr. Ed Moore.
Howdy. Oh, howdy.
That was just perfect. Let me ask you a question.
Okay.
How much do you pay for a gallon of milk in your part of the country?
I don't know. Let me see. $4.10.
Wow.
I think is rather exorbitant.
Yeah. I think ours is about three. Well, if you're going name brand, yeah, it's probably about that much. But if you're going store brand, it's about $3.70 a gallon around here.
The cow don't know no different. What?
Right.
What,
yeah.
You know, it,
exactly.
Okay. Yeah.
Reason I bring it up is for those of you watching live, we were 30 minutes late tonight. And it's because we had run out of milk and I had driven into the next town over, which is 3 minutes away to the little local store to pick up a gallon of milk. And I go in there to find there's no milk. Their coolers are bare. So there's two small convenience stores in that town as well. I go to one. They don't even carry milk. I go to the other and all they have are half gallons. And I end up, they were $3.69. per half gallon. I paid over $8 after tax for a gallon of milk tonight, and I'm not happy about it. But right. I am very much one of the I have to have a glass of milk before bed. Oh, I just have to.
You do what you got to do. I mean, yeah. It's not right, and you can bitch and moan about it, but food is like gasoline. You got to get it, and you got to get it. You have no choice. So. You know, that's why, even though the prices for these things may be, in my estimation, too high, I don't even try to complain about it because I honestly have no choice. My choice has been made to do it. And it's like, okay, well, if that's the cost of doing it, then there we go.
Yeah. Terry says that you guys shop at Kroger.
At Kroger. Yeah. That's where we do most of our shopping.
And Doug says, wow, convenience store markup is real. Yeah. You're paying for the convenience.
That's, yeah,
but we have a Kroger branded store over in Lawrence. It's Dillon's. That's what they.
Okay.
Yeah. But it's a Kroger. Dillon's. Yeah, we'll go there and we'll go there often. But yeah, so was on a quest for milk tonight, and that's why I was delayed.
Did you accomplish your quest?
Yeah, I paid over $8 for a gallon.
Okay. Well, there you go.
But milk is the one thing. One of the things that I'm not supposed to have on this diet. I can use it when I cook, but I'm not supposed to just drink milk. But
oh, well.
Again, I can't. Yeah.
Look, you have to be able to sustain the diet.
Yeah.
And so that's why you have to be allowed to make exceptions, because if not, you won't be able to sustain nothing. I can't have this. I can't have that. Well, don't worry because you won't keep at that very long.
You know, my doctor's cool with it. She understands, because, you know, I've cut out so much.
Right.
But, it's the milk thing is more psychological than anything else. And I distinctly remember one night, last year, I think it was, where I was getting ready for bed and I open up the fridge and there's no milk. It's like, y'all ran us out of milk and you didn't tell me. So I had to throw some clothes back on and get in the car. Yeah. I tried to handle it. I'm like, all right, well, I guess I'm just going to bed without milk. And I just, the thought of it just got me all jittery. And we live in a super small town, and the town over where I went tonight, everything over there closes down at like 9:30. This was like 10:30. So I had to drive the 20 minutes into Lawrence to get
you're going to
milk.
Big town.
Yeah.
Where they still have sidewalks out.
But I'm always interested how, you know, how much everybody pays for a gallon of milk in various areas of the country.
Did you have some more feedback that you were going to throw out?
No.
Oh, okay. I thought there was more feedback by the way you said that last episode.
Yeah.
Okay.
No, I just had more banter stuff. And one
more your milk banter.
Talk about the milk. Yeah. Yep. Yep.
Does the body good?
It does. Does the body big too. All right. Banter complete.
Complete.
Chum chum. Okay. So today we're looking at a story called Superman on the High Seas. It appeared in Action Comics number 15. The writer of this story was Jerry Siegel. Paul Cassidy did pencils and inks, according to the sources that we can find. Action Comics number 15 was, of course, published by DC Comics. It's got a cover date of August 1939, and according to Mike's Amazing World of Comics, an approximate sale date of June 29th, 1939.
Oh, that's barely. That's almost the same month.
Yeah, practically. So let me tell you what happened. Clark Kent is sent to Kid Town to write a story about it. He interviews the man responsible for creating Kid Town, a place where underprivileged boys are sent in order to have a chance to rehabilitate themselves and stay away from crime. During the interview, the man in charge of Kid Town says he is in deep debt and must pay off $2 million in 2 weeks in order to keep the town alive. After the interview, Clark Kent decides that he will raise the money himself, but ponders how he will do it. He already has $1 million from when he sold his oil stock back in the black gold swindle issue. Talk about that in a bit. Within minutes, Clark stops two men who robbed a bank and is given $5,000 as a reward for stopping them. Later, a wealthy man is walking behind Clark, pondering what to do with his wealth. Suddenly, a car loses control and hits a tree near Clark and the wealthy man, and the tree crashes on top of both of the men, trapping them. Still, as Clark, Superman lifts the tree off the man, and he is given $10,000 for saving him. Back at the Daily Star, Clark is sent to interview well-known explorer Warren Kenyon, who just had returned from a treasure hunt. Kenyon shows Clark a treasure map that marks the spot of a sunken Spanish galleon in the middle of the ocean. It is embedded in coral, which makes it impossible to blast through, but the ship has about $1 million of gold in it. After Clark returns from his interview and prints the story about Warren Kenyon and the sunken treasure, he takes a two-week vacation and plans to get the gold himself. Big Boy Cheney reads about the treasure and plans to go after it. Another gang headed by Marchetti also has the same idea after reading the article and sends Muggsy to keep tabs on Clark Kent. Muggsy learns that Clark is going to take a vacation and follows him to a shipping office where Clark is renting a boat called the Dragon. Whew, this is a long synopsis. Marchetti and his henchmen decide to knock out the sailors looking for work in order to be hired by Clark on his expedition. Meanwhile, Big Boy's mob steals the D-11 government submarine, and they head toward the sunken treasure. The Dragon has arrived at the spot of the treasure, and Clark is lowered into the ocean in a diving bell. After Clark tells the crew he has found it, Muggsy cuts off Clark's oxygen tube. Assuming that Clark has died, the crew bring the diving bell up and find that Clark is gone, and there's a hole in the diving bell. Clark had escaped moments before and has changed into Superman. After fighting off multiple sharks, Superman tears through the coral and finds dead sailors and the gold. The stolen D-11 has arrived. They send two men to explore the ship to take the treasure. Hiding, Superman dresses as one of the dead sailors and scares the men into believing that ghosts are after them. As the D-11 is fleeing, Superman breaks off their propellers and throws them up towards a battleship that is searching for the stolen submarine. Superman dresses back as Clark Kent, and his crew finds him and takes him back into the ship. Clark finds that his oxygen tube was cut off and decides to take a nap without a worry, since he is Superman. The crew sneaks into Clark's cabin and stabs him with a knife while he sleeps. As the knife breaks, Clark jumps up and beats the crew up and calls the authorities to arrest the men. The next day, an anonymous donor has donated $2 million to Kid Town and has saved it. Ed, that was a big synopsis. What did you think of this story?
First of all, I have to say, with no planning, this week is Discovery Channel's Shark Week. We have hit the theme.
Fun.
There you go. You know, it's kind of tough to do superhero comics and squeeze into a shark-themed week, but we managed to do it. Here it is. Now, when the podcast comes out, it'll be after. But right now, as we're talking, we're in the middle of Shark Week. So there's our offering for Shark Week. Thank you. Thank you. Brings to mind, when I was growing up, we were always threatened as juveniles. If we went bad, we would go to a place called Pruny Town, which was in the northern part of the state. I would imagine every state has those stories, legends, whatever, of the juvenile male correctional institute that you get sent to. In West Virginia, it was Pruny Town. So I assume that this is very similar to that, although it's not, Kid Town is not for punishment per se, the way this reads, but it could be. And so, yeah, immediately, Pruny Town's been closed for about 20 years now. I think they just sent them to regular jail. Yeah. I got kind of a problem with Superman taking rewards. It kind of goes against that Ma and Pa raising.
Yeah, Superman today would not. No need to thank me.
It's like, yeah, I'll do the right thing for a price.
I mean, granted, he's taking the reward so he can use it to save Kids Town. So we don't know if, you know, had that not been the case, the question is, would he have accepted that reward? I think he would have.
I don't know.
I think he still would have taken the money and then just added it to the million that he's been holding on to.
It's an ends means kind of issue there with, you know, taking, but, you know. So that aside, it's obvious by the way that the story progresses why that is even happening. I mean, he has never, as far as we know, he has never been offered a reward before in any strip at all. That money was money that he, as Clark Kent, invested and made bank on as, you know, righting a wrong, but which he would have anyway. It was an investment like any human being would invest. So that's a different kind of thing. But yeah, every time the reward came up, I'm like, oh, Superman taking a reward? What?
Yep.
I do like the gentleman that has so much money, literally, that he says he doesn't know what to do with it.
Yeah.
I'm thinking, dog, let me help.
Right.
You know, I can, it's.
Yep. I can, know. I have some ideas.
Yes. We can talk and we'll come up with something for you to do with your money. That's not a problem.
And he actually says, I mean, okay. First of all, you have these two super coincidences.
Yeah.
Clark leaves this interview thinking, I got to try to raise this money. And boom, bank robbery, gets a reward. Right. And then as he's walking away from that, panel 16, the guy just is walking behind him and he's thinking to himself, how strange life is. Here I have so much money, I don't know what to do with it all. And my existence bores me.
Wow.
Okay. Wow, indeed.
This is... In 1939, this is like first world problems right here.
Yeah, right.
This is,
right.
Yeah. Wow. Yeah.
His existence bores him.
How many years ago and we have an example of first world problems?
Yep, right there.
So, go ahead.
Well, I made a lot of notes. I made many more notes for this one that I did any of the other two stories we're talking about tonight.
Go right ahead then.
I'll say that I enjoyed the crap out of this story. And it had a lot of moments that had me laughing or scratching my head. Panel two, when the chief tells Clark that he wants him to go interview the guy from Kid Town, Clark's reaction is, "Say, that is a good idea." I don't know why that made me laugh, but it makes Clark sound like a real suck up.
It kind of comes out of nowhere. It's like, you're awful enthusiastic, dog.
We've all seen Monty Python and the Quest for the Holy Grail, right?
Or we should have.
If you haven't, stop and go watch it. But there's the moment in the movie when God shows up and tells Arthur that he wants to give him a quest. And Arthur goes, "That's a good idea." And God's just like, "Oh, of course it's a good idea." But it makes me think of that. You know, it's like this, you know, Clark just seems like a real suck up in that panel. "That's a great idea, boss." Yeah.
That's something Jimmy Olsen would say.
Right?
The Superman Super Show will return after these messages. And now back to the Superman Super Show.
Panel 11, when he stops the bank robbery, one of the bad guys shoots him in the chest, and Clark's response is, "Bullets? Ha! I eat them for breakfast." And then commences to kick in their butts. That was funny.
Yeah, he's been getting pretty snotty about his invulnerability here lately.
Yeah, he's pretty cocky about it, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. At this point, I keep thinking, you wait until Green Kryptonite, dog, and we'll see.
Yeah, and I mean, if you're looking at the panel, just look at him. He's standing there with his kind of his chest out, and his hands are in his pocket. I mean, he's just casually just chilling,
pulling his jacket back. You know, pulling his jacket back because it's behind his hands that are in his pocket. Yep. He's just like bullets. Ha!
Very funny.
Wow, dog. Okay.
I already mentioned the rich guy whose existence bores him. But one thing that was really odd about that encounter, panel 22, when the tree is on top of the guy, and Clark says, "I can't let him die, but if I display super strength, it may give away my true identity as Superman," which just moments before he didn't seem to care about. When he let a bad guy shoot him in the chest and laugh it off.
Because the bad guy's going to be arrested, and then when he tells people, who's going to believe him? But if he's out in public and somebody just sees, that's kind of different. I mean, you know.
Yeah, but it's not the first moment. I guess the other moment in this book when he displays his superpowers again, not as Superman, it's in front of criminals again as well. So, yeah.
Right, that's, so, you know, they're going to be telling the police, but they're not going to believe him.
Yeah, that's a good point. Skip forward to panels 43 and 44. So Clark has hired this ship and he needs to hire a crew, and the mob guys show up and beat up the sailors, and the sailors run off. And that's when Clark walks up to the mob guys and says, "You men, your men will do on board." And it makes me feel like Clark was just standing there watching this happen. And just seeing who would win. Who's going to win this fight? Whoever wins, that's who's going to crew my ship.
I want the tougher guys. That's who I want on my crew.
Right. We learn in panel 64 that Clark can hold his breath for hours underwater. That is handled very kind of nonchalantly. It's almost like, by the way, in case you're wondering, he can hold his breath for hours underwater.
There's another superpower that we haven't really seen yet or been told about yet.
Yeah. And then, let's see, panel 68, the note I wrote is read the text box. So let me grab. Okay. So yes, this is during the fight when he fights the sharks, and the text box describing the fight, I thought was just poetry. "Flailing, tearing, Superman beats back and destroys the deadly fighters of the sea who fail to pierce his impenetrable skin and evade his crushing metallic grip. Beaten back, the surviving sharks flee. Superman has emerged victorious." Seems kind of silly nowadays that Superman's fighting sharks, but
it is Shark Week. So, I mean, you do what you got to do to be part, you know?
That's right.
And as you were reading that, I heard David Attenborough in my head.
Right.
Right. That's funny. You know, talking about, take the word Superman out and put another animal or just leave it open. And I think Attenborough has said that in one of the Oceanic things that he's put out. Has emerged Victoria. Yeah, I'm just like, that's it's Attenborough script right there.
And then I noted the scene where Superman takes the submarine, grabs a hold of it, stops it from moving, tears off the propeller, and then throws it up to the surface. That is, like we talked about in the last episode, that's another moment where I think they have done a great job showing how powerful he is and what he can do. I thought it was when I read through that sequence, all I could think of was that was pretty awesome what Superman just did.
And it's funny because what I thought was he'd be neck deep in the muck at the bottom of the ocean from having shoved that submarine. Yeah. You know, there's got to be some back force on that, but he's like,
I'll admit the panel where he grabs the sub Reaching out, Superman seizes the sub in a grip of steel, preventing it from moving. And my first thought was, how? He's in the water.
Right.
You know, it's not like he's grabbing onto something else. But, you know, this is the Superman that would eventually be on the Super Friends and would fly out into space and grab the Earth by its atmosphere
and
push it around.
Right. Yeah. So. Okay. We'll allow it. Yeah. But yeah.
Those are the only notes. So that's the end of my notes. But I really enjoyed this story, and I loved the coincidences of him just stumbling into money like that.
Right.
But this was not a typical Action Comics story.
No.
While he is trying to right a wrong, he's not going out there and destroying something. He's not.
Right. Not aggro.
Yeah. He's not tearing a building down and is like, you're not going to do this anymore. He's trying to raise $2 million in 2 weeks to, you know, if this was the Blues Brothers, they would be out there doing a big show in Chicago to save the church.
If he were one of the Blues Brothers, he'd have told everybody that he was on a mission from God.
Mission from God. You know, okay, I'm going to segue for a moment here. I love the Blues Brothers movie.
Absolutely.
Love it. And it was on TV just the other day, and I caught the last half of it. The whole car chase at the end when they're done at the show and they have to take the money into the Cooks County's assessor's office. That is I told my daughter who was in the room with me, I said, this is one of the single most epic car chases in cinematic history. In the 90s, I worked at a comic book store, and a customer who had come in all the time that was about my age, we got to discussing the upcoming convention that was happening in Chicago that year. And we just decided, well, let's go. Let's just go this year. And, you know, I was single and could do stuff like that.
A half a tank of gas.
Yeah. So we go to Chicago. First thing, we walked around Chicago on one of the days and came to that area, the building where they run into to pay that fee.
Oh, okay.
But it was surrounded by construction fencing. So we couldn't.
Daily building or something like
that. Yeah, we couldn't get to it. But I remember literally looking through a knot hole in the fence and going, holy crap, that's the plaza that all the soldiers converge on and everything. That's the actual place. And then before we left the convention, we're leaving. We get together and we're leaving. And I told him, I said, check out what I found. And it was a poster of the Blues Brothers sitting on the hood of their car. And that we've got a half a pack of cigarettes, a tank full of gas and 200 miles and blah, blah, blah. And the dude that I went with was like, oh, look. And he had one too. We both found that poster and
nice.
Copies that poster and bought it. So
just as a tangential, I was born in the state of Illinois in the county of Cook in the city of Chicago.
Very nice.
So I was born in Cook County Hospital, which I don't believe they mentioned in the movie, but
yeah. Doug says he loves the Blues Brothers as well.
Blues Brothers are awesome. That was one of the three movies that got me through weekends when I was in college. I had three movies on run all the time, and Blues Brothers was one of them.
It's a great movie, and it's very interesting. One of the things I like most about the Blues Brothers is just the fact that Dan Aykroyd and Jim Belushi. Is it Jim or John? No, I think it's Jim. John.
Or, John.
I'm yeah. Sorry. Jim did the show The World According to Jim. Dan Aykroyd and John Belushi meet on, you know, working on Saturday Night Live, and they learn that they both have this shared love of that kind of music, and they start jamming together. And then the Lorne Michaels lets them start warming up the crowd and, you know, before shows. And then they turn it into not really a sketch, but live performances on the show that are entertaining and funny.
Mm-hmm.
And then it becomes this wonderful movie. And the fact that they're, you know, Dan Aykroyd's actually playing the harmonica, they're actually singing, you know, a lot of times they'd be lip syncing for, you know, somebody else would be doing, you know, the band, with the exception of one guy in the movie. And I don't remember which guy it is. The band is the actual band from Saturday Night Live.
Because they tour after the movie.
Yeah.
They tour and release albums.
I have one of the a CD of theirs called Briefcase Full of Blues that has one of their live shows.
So do I.
Really good. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Love it. All right. Anything you want to bring up about this story?
I just want to keep talking Blues Brothers now. But,
we're going to start a Blues Brothers podcast.
That would be awesome. Yeah. We could review each episode, one song from. Yep. Oh, yeah.
We could do one of those, you know. I don't know if you listen. I don't, but those podcasts that do like a minute
of
a movie at a time.
Yep.
Yep.
A minute of blues.
I don't think I could do that.
There would be the name of the podcast, A Minute of Blues. Doug had that album too.
All right.
Yes.
See, there's a reason why we're all here together.
I bet that weirdo Chris Parton didn't. I bet he's not even seen the Blues Brothers. I'm gonna throw that out there. Gauntlet Down. It's like
bam.
No, I don't think there's really anything. I did enjoy this quite a bit because of the it did just to some extent it just seemed lighter than a lot of the other stories because he wasn't on this crusade necessarily. I mean he was trying to raise money, but he was not on a crusade to right a wrong. And so the whole piece just had a different feel to it, I think. A lot of levity. A lot of And interestingly enough, though, it's been written by the same guy pretty much that's written them all. So that, you know, the tone really shouldn't be different per se.
Yeah.
But it did seem to have almost like a somebody else wrote this script kind of tonal difference.
And maybe somebody else did.
Perhaps so. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You know, you hear the stories how Bob Kane is attributed to the art in Detective Comics for I don't know how many years. Right. A lot of it is people he hired.
They ghosted him. He was ghosted, I guess. Yeah, is the way that you would put it.
He had this studio of hired artists that would do a lot of that stuff. Yep.
So no, I don't think there's really anything else that I wanted to highlight.
All right. Oh, I just lost my camera.
Yeah. Now I will say that I noticed that too.
Let me try to. I'm unplugging it and plugging it back in. Usually that will. Turn it back on. There we go. But yeah, I agree with you. Very different. It was a very different story than what we're used to. And I think that's one of the reasons I really enjoyed this one.
Okay.
It seemed to be, I don't know, he was underwater, first of all. That's pretty cool.
Yeah.
You know? But very enjoyable. All right. Let me close this sucker out. I want to thank everyone for listening to this episode of the Superman Super Show. If you want to drop us a line, ask us a question. Or just provide feedback, you can send an email to the Superman Super Show at gmail.com. You can also reach out to us over on Twitter at Supes Super Show, SUPS Super Show. Link will be in the show notes. You can come join us for all the fun over at the forum at forum.justanotherfanboy.com. There is a message board for the Superman Super Show. Come post. Be part of the forum. I think we're up to 18 members. I want to try to hit 25 by the end of August. That's my goal. So yeah, that's it. All the links will be in the show notes. So until next week, I'm Steven, and that's Ed, and this was the Superman Super Show.
Ciao. Bye.
We want to thank you for listening to this episode of the Superman Super Show. Questions and comments can be directed to the Superman Super Show at gmail.com. If you enjoyed the show, you can help to boost our presence online by leaving a rating or review on your favorite podcast app. The Superman Super Show is a presentation of Steven or Else Media. For more nerdy content just like this, check out stevenorelse.com or just use the link in your show notes. Superman is a registered trademark of DC Comics and was created by Jerry Siegel and Joe Shuster.
Superman is a copyrighted feature appearing in Action Comics magazine.
Superman's bad. I mean, he was bad.
Suddenly, a car loses control and hits a tree near Clark, and the wealthy man and the tree. Oh, you can't read that wrong.